say in 1915, you know, every summer they would put the guys who fought in the Civil War would put on their gray uniforms and march down the street.
Right.
So they had the consciousness of a conquered nation. So they were really not part of this completely, even though John B. Watson was. But he became a Yankee when he went to the University of Chicago.
Mm-hmm. The attack on the church took a lot of different forms, and you talk about that, but probably one of the most pernicious forms we alluded to earlier was to try to get a fifth column established.
Yeah.
Try to buy out some key leaders.
Yeah.
Charismatic leaders.
Yeah. Yeah. And Theodore Hesburgh was the man, the paradigm of this sellout. I mean, as I said, that the battle over obscenity was a Catholic-Jewish battle, but
right.
The battle over birth control was a Catholic-Protestant battle.
Mm-hmm.
That was the WASP ruling class, epitomized by the Rockefeller family. And the scion in this regard of the Rockefeller family was John D. Rockefeller III, who founded the Population Institute in 1950, but he got involved in this in the 1930s. And he got involved in it basically because the Catholics beat the Protestants on birth control. And by beat, I mean that the government was going to get involved in birth control in the 1930s, and the Catholics, people like Monsignor Ryan and the Catholic bishops, beat them. And the government did not get involved. So this was like the high point of Catholic cultural influence. The 1930s, when basically the Legion of Decency got started and Monsignor Ryan defeated Margaret Sanger in battle in the American Congress.
Mm-hmm. But what was the secret to Catholic success back then, as far as you're able to tell? And perhaps that's also the secret for the Catholic disintegration beginning in the 60s.
Yeah, poverty and solidarity. And the combination of those things was the ethnic neighborhood.
And the culmination was that ethnic neighborhood with the parish in the middle.
Yeah, this was this is actually Paul Blanchard and his brother Brand spent a summer in Bridesburg in Philadelphia in a Polish neighborhood, and they said it was just absolutely impenetrable, and these people will never become Americans. They just gave up and walked away in disgust. So that was it was sort of a group solidarity based on coherent local communities. Where the priest had a role of spiritual leadership, and where the bishop was not afraid to antagonize other groups. For example, Cardinal Dougherty called for a boycott of the Warner Brothers theaters in 1934 in Philadelphia. And everybody knew this was a battle between Catholics and Jews. Everybody knew that. And the Catholics won. And the Jews had to put in place the production code in Hollywood, which existed for 31 years until 1965. So what happened during the early 60s, coincident with the Second Vatican Council, the Jews and the WASPs started looking for people to collaborate with. Collaborators is the word that was used for the people in France who worked with the Nazis. And I think it's an apt term here. And Hesburgh was a collaborator.
Right.
So what happened is that Rockefeller, John D. Rockefeller, thought that Vatican II would be an opening to change the church's teaching on birth control. And so what his people, Cass Canfield, who was on the Population Council, I think also the head of Planned Parenthood in New York in the early 60s, arranged to have a series of secret conferences at the University of Notre Dame from about 1963 until 1965, at which they specified, pretty much told Hesburgh, we want you to change the church's teaching. They didn't say it that bluntly. It was just going, hey, we're going to explore the issue and blah, blah, blah. But then they also said, look, you're not allowed to invite these people. Father Zimmerman was one of them who's not allowed to be invited because he was a promoter of, natural family planning. He was an opponent of contraception.
So once again, we're seeing very sophisticated control saying, you know, we just want to explore this topic.
Yeah, we're just we'll give you money. We'll give you money. The Rockefellers are going to give Notre Dame money. And if there's one thing Notre Dame loves, it's money.
Well.
And they love the idea, like Kinsey. Hesburgh was like Kinsey in this regard, because he felt that by associating with the Rockefellers, he got credibility, a credibility that he didn't have just by being some Catholic priest.
Do you think Hesburgh was trying to advance the Catholic faith, the Catholic religion?
I think he was trying to get money. I think that's what he wanted, money and prestige. That's what he wanted.
There seems to me that in talking about Paul Blanchard and his trip to the ethnic neighborhoods and opposing that with Ted Hesburgh and Notre Dame, that there's been a real falling away from the spiritual and an embracing of the material as the primary means to, as the primary purpose of life.
Well, the word would be assimilation. And so there were people who felt that the Catholics were an unassimilable minority. Certainly Paul Blanchard felt that way.
Mm-hmm.
But by the 1960s, there were people who felt that, no, we can work out some modus vivendi between Catholics. And the man who was the theoretical, the man who came up with the theoretical justification for that was John Courtney Murray. And he wrote a book called "We Hold These Truths," which I think is not a bad book. I mean, he says that the essence of America is morality, and at the end of the book, he said if that Constitution were ever threatened, Catholics could withdraw their allegiance. Well, that's exactly what happened the minute he appeared on the cover of Time magazine. You know, he was sort of the paradigm. He was sort of the paradigm of the American Catholic during Vatican II. When we no longer feared the modern world and blah, 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 and so on and so forth. And what happened is that Catholics got taken to the cleaners politically. They lost all their political power.
Even though John Kennedy was elected president about that time.
Yes, that was the culmination of Catholic political power. So the culmination of that arc that began in, let's say, 1934 when Cardinal Doherty organized the boycott of Warner Brothers theaters in Philadelphia. You could take that to its apogee by going back to Philadelphia in 1962. July 4th, 1962, Independence Square, Philadelphia. You have on the platform there a Catholic president of the United States, a Catholic governor of the state of Pennsylvania, and a Catholic mayor of Philadelphia. Now, that was sort of the high point of Catholic political power.
That's pretty powerful. They have all Catholics there.
Yeah.
But to a degree, they had to sell out, or they had to give up the faith. Is that a fair statement?
To a degree, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Although Kennedy, I mean, you know, it's still an open book. He did do that speech to the Dallas ministers,
right,
which was not a good explanation of the relationship between church and state from the Catholic perspective.
Right.
But on the other hand, I think that John F. Kennedy was the last man, or let's say maybe next to the last man, who felt he had a mandate from the American people, as opposed to a mandate from the rich and powerful who paid his campaign expenses. So, I mean, the epitome of that would be Bill Clinton, who was like this piece of poor white trash from Arkansas who got a Rhodes Scholarship, and so as a result had been anointed by the powers, and then he just carried out their bidding by, you know, like NAFTA, GATT, those things, which sold out the interest of the great majority of the American people and the Democratic Party, but that's not who he represented.
Right.
Whereas John F. Kennedy, I think, did feel he represented the American people, or certainly had a mandate, and I think that's probably why he got killed.